The following is a special presentation of the American Forces Network Europe. Some material contains adult content. Parental discretion is advised.
A lot of guys are drinking their own urine, right? It's close. It has this much alcohol from 4 years ago. Buddha's in the house. Keep it real. Buddha's in the house. Throwing it down.
It's nice to be here, guys. I'm glad I made it in. And I'm glad the dust is down this much today. I like the guy that got off the plane and said, "You came on a beautiful day, sir."
All right, thanks for joining us. We're here with Robin Williams, who's just coming off the final leg of a tour.
Final leg of a tour, yes. It's the Afghan Open, as we say. 18th hole will be ready soon once they have the mines cleared, but it's very nice over there. The Bagram Open, Kandahar. It feels like Bob Hope. It's one big sand trap, I'll tell you. It's wild.
Your experience in Afghanistan, let's talk about being there. What did you do, first of all?
What did I do? Got off the plane, which is always the first step, and then went around and visited pretty much everybody I could. At Bagram, it was, my God, it was a couple of thousand people. I know there's more. I'm not allowed to say how many.
Or else I have to go into a witness protection program, and we will not talk about this.
But mainly just going around shaking hands, meeting little performances. The first time I went into, there was a very, very small building, an Afghani sauna with about 300 people. It's not really a sauna. It's okay. I forget. He's going, really? This is the first talk show I've done since I've been back. And there's about 300 guys, did about 25 minutes, and then signed autographs and pictures and took pictures with everybody. Then went around and met different units, which was the best.
Is this your first time doing the USO experience, getting out there with the troops?
Yeah, it was good. For me, I mean, I wanted to go over there specifically to Afghanistan and to those bases because it's, you know, to let them know people at home haven't forgotten them and, you know, to say, and also when I get back to tell people don't forget the people there because, you know, no matter what happens with Iraq, you want to say that there is a war going on there. There are people there who've been there for a long time, you know, rebuilding, doing all the thing, and still carrying on. And you just to say, hey, what's up, dude? What's happening, brother?
Mm-mm, Ms. Williams, you put your name down. Don't make me go Oprah on your ass.
A lot of people go, what are you doing here? I don't know, man. That was a real weird bet. And I met a lot of great people, a lot of great people. It's incredible. There's a lot of extraordinary, and then you see it's also because most of the bases are coalition bases. I would say, hi, how you doing? They go, very good today. And it's like a camouflage fashion show. You know, I have the Swedes, the Estonians, the Romanians. It feels like Estonia or Romania. It's like an old Marx Brothers routine. Ah, Fredonia.
You know, a lot of people, when they think of a USO tour, they're thinking Wayne Newton, Bob Hope, you know, now these guys out there
now
on the field.
Now they kind of change the parameters. Because ours just kind of put the tits on Mickey Mouse. We just all of a sudden change the parameters and boys are going, woo!
Oh, it's a joy to be here. Thank you very much. I haven't had meals ready to excrete, but I'm hoping to. It's nice when you have food, you get into different countries, and all of a sudden everything in your body goes, everybody out!
Did you say meals ready to excrete? Yes, sir. People had fun. I would talk about, they would tell me things, and I would kind of incorporate those into the shows.
Or the one day they will get Osama bin Laden, he will go to the gates of heaven, and there will be George Washington going, how dare you defile that which we created. And 70 other members of the Continental Congress come down and start kicking the shit out of him. And bin Laden's going, where are the virgins? 71 Virginians, you asshole! Mission!
Plus, flying in, you know, in a C-130, which is basically a vibrator with wheels. But it was nice. Yeah, get off the plane. Thank you. That was a really wonderful experience. And you get off the plane if you don't wear earplugs. It's very difficult. Because the plane is very loud. That's a loud plane, the T-130. And I can't hear you. Get off the plane. It's like a baby. The drawers will drop and we're going to poop you out. Along with a couple of pilots and a Hummer, and I'm talking about the car, a Hummer, right there. And they fix the Hummers all over the world. They're everywhere. I mean, There's a Hummer dealership there. Look, 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 my friend, look. Look, almost
2,000 feet over the runway. I get over the end.
Wow!
Nice land.
Nice. And points? 8.5.
8.5. This is your first time on a military aircraft?
The first time, and it's been an experience. Flying on the C-17's a joy. That thing could fit Anna Nicole Smith. It's wonderful. They could actually load her, and she might scrape the sides. But I think it's a good plane, a great plane, because you could... It's nice when you see guys playing basketball in the middle of a plane, but... and I realize there's one plane bigger than that. I guess we're not allowed to say the number, the big, you know, the larger steroid model. But it's it was a great experience and great pilots. You know, it's also good when you're on the plane and you hear the different,
Alpha strap on, this is Big Dildo. Come on home, Daddy. You're vectored over Areola 1, going around the turn now. Thank you.
And it's been a great flight, great pilots, too.
Good morning, Vietnam! Hey, this is not a test. This is rock and roll.
Am I being fairly clear?
Yes, sir.
Sir, do you see anything on this uniform indicating an officer? What does three up and three down mean to you, Airman?
End of an inning.
For us in the military, you're definitely no stranger to all of us because of Good Morning Vietnam.
Right. A lot of times I would go into different places and they would mount the mandatory, Good Morning Vietnam! You go, yeah! And then the one guy who on, you know, the one guy was on day sleep at that time, go, we won't be able to use that. But, yeah, ixnay on apkai. But it was good to do, excuse me. Still a little dust left over. You actually fart a brick in Bagram. It's a nice thing to, because of all the dust, it just kind of eventually just and it can be used for building. It's lovely. There is so much dust there that even Lawrence of Arabia would go, no. Walking down the street, we landed, it was beautiful. I thought, oh, this is not bad. And they said, Mr. Williams, just wait 5 minutes. All of a sudden,
oh, yeah. the windstorm.
You see guys wearing these goggles going, you'll wear them. You'll look like Elliot phone home. Elliot. But there's a lot of great people.
Viagra! She's going, my God, it was like a cat. It's like a cat going, I own it.
What are some of the differences between Turkey and Afghanistan for you?
Oh, the crater's number one. You see a lot of that, the stay on the rocky paths, number two. You know, you see, I met a group of guys, also Kandahar, too, that said that they were, you know, just on a routine kind of patrol, and they ran over an anti-personnel mine, it was an anti-tank mine, blew the back off, everybody was safe. But, you know, the difference is that it's also, you know, that there's a lot of stuff going on. Turkey's, you know, a support zone, Bagram, Kandahar, there are things going on. There's a lot of people wearing beards. And, you know, are you in special forces? Could be. Could be. Then when you hear, you see a guy full Afghani outfit go, dude, what's up? Special forces, man. Shh. Shalom. It's okay.
Now, working on a movie like Good Morning Vietnam, did that give you some history, some kind of insight into
somewhat,
the military?
I mean, it gave me the idea of, you know, I mean, I think it connected me with the idea of that what you do. I'm guessing this is Armed Forces Network.
Yeah, exactly.
Bingo. And it's the idea that, you know, people, the information is most important, and also just
and
simple things, music, entertainment, you know. A big thing in a lot of those places is, especially Bagram, we've got to go home and have them send groups of PlayStation 2, because it's a thing of just little things, because when you come back, a lot of times, yeah, there's combat, hardcore stuff, and then it's a lot of waiting around, and it's that stuff where people need things just to fight the boredom, and that is most important. And I think most people just kind of shocked that someone showed up, like, why are you here, man?
Yeah.
And it was good.
What are you going to take away from it? Are you going to do
a lot
another
of dust?
Yeah.
I'm just going to take away just the thing I picked up best for me was people said, how can you keep going? You get this incredible energy back. People just glad you came. And for me, it was a joy. It was like you see people saying, hey, thanks. And that's why I want to do it. That's the purpose, was showing up and saying, I haven't forgotten. People back home haven't forgotten. And you're doing, you know, great work. And just to say, and it was mutual. I would just go, there's a joy. You see people kind of light up and go, hey, thanks, man. And a lot of people would say that. You'd be signing pictures and people would lean over and say, thanks. Thanks for doing this. And that to me, you know, this is cool because it made it all worthwhile. It was a symbiotic experience on that level. Plus, seeing, you know, that where they are, basically rebuilding from the ground up. country that's been devastated. And, you know, programs, hospitals that are being sent up, you know, set up, you know, and within a week and fully functioning. And, the, you know, the transition from bases who started, I guess, in Bagram initially, they had tents that were blowing away. And all these guys are putting up, you know, more permanent buildings. And then the next step is, you know, expanding and making it better and better. And that was kind of part of the experience. But mostly for me was meeting all these extraordinary people, men, women, all ages. I met guys, I met Vietnam vets, guys who had come back. One guy was 60, and he was going, what's up? He said, I'm back, they needed me. I was like, you know, a lot of people. And then you'd see people, I want to see some ID.
Yeah. Oh, come on, Mr. Williams. That's bullshit. They needed some people to just get in and clean out the engine there, and that's okay.
Oh, hold on. Hello? Second, are we going over? Yeah. Oh, yeah, Afghan online. You've got Vail. No, it's okay. But it is that thing of, for me, the best thing was just a hands-on contact. A lot of times just shaking someone's hand and saying, what's up? And that meant something, I guess. A lot of guys said, thanks, it helped. And that, for me, that's all I needed.
How did 9/11 affect you personally?
Affect me personally? It's devastating. It was this thing of, you know, it's kind of total shock. You know, it was the kind of a thing that happens as in any tragedy where you have, like, there's the stages of shock, and then there was no stage of denial. There's just only the stage of shock, and then you go into rage, and then you go into action, which is that kind of thing of what do? And this is that thing about after a year to say this, you know, this is what it's still being pursued. And that was the purpose of going over there, of saying, you know, a year, you've been here. A lot of them have been there since, you know, some of them came a week after it, you know, a couple of weeks after when they were, you know, advanced operations. So to say, you know, a year later, let you know that people haven't forgotten you. Because sometimes back in America, there'll be this thing of it's all focusing on Iraq and whatever happens there. Is to say, listen, whatever happens there is one thing. You are here. This is a given. You are, you know, to pardon the phrase, you are in the shit. And that is why to say that, you know, I'm here to say, hey, not to forget. I was trying to come over earlier in September, but, you know, back home there was, you know, it's always that heightened alert, which is every so often Rumsfeld comes out and goes, I don't know where, I don't know when, but something awful's going to happen. That's all for today. Can you help tell us anymore? Can't. That's all.
Yeah. How do you prepare?
You don't prepare for this. You just come and do kind of, I mean, mix in. It's like the same way I did it when I toured America. Doing some of the show, I mean, I did this HBO show, so I had at least material. So it wasn't like, hi, where are you from? Yeah, why I'm here. Is to find a lot of references for each base, things that have been going on, talking about stuff that they're experiencing. Like in Pakistan, they have buses that look like they were painted by people. Even Brazil would go, there's too many colors. You know, you got a lot going on. And you just throw in things and people, it's kind of dedicated to them and that start that, and then you just go off and talk about everything else. And then, you know, it's an adult show, but, you know, there are only adults out there. It was pretty wild because one time we were performing at one base and there were these guys sitting, I later on realized it wasn't a propane tank, but there was a guy sitting on a propane tank smoking a cigarette and went, dude, explosive ordnance, ammo! But, you know, and then the crowd, but it was a lot of stuff just kind of gleaned talking to people and worked in, and people dug it.
I want to talk to you a little bit about, you know, Robin Williams as a whole. Right now you're
as
in the middle.
As a whole, thank you. Versus a half. Yeah.
Right now you're in the middle of just, it seems like a tremendously busy schedule. Your HBO special, Insomnia.
So I cleaned the body up, removed all trace of evidence that connected to me.
Except for your novel.
Under pressure, you don't always see the wood for the trees. You, for one, should have figured that one out by now.
A one-hour photo.
You're a very lucky man, Mr. Yorkin.
I'm sorry?
You have a wonderful family. And if you don't mind my saying so, a very beautiful house, too.
A lot of these movies coming out, Death is Smoochie just came out in the spring, and you up and decide, well, I'm going to go to Afghanistan.
Well, because I had time off. It was good news because I was doing the last bit of press in Europe. It was actually a combination of Insomnia and one-hour photo, so I saved half a trip, so I flew from there, from Italy to Turkey, and that was great. For me, that was, because if you go on the full 21-hour trip, I mean, I think the first few days would have been really kind of like, hello, Mr. Williams. Hi, how are you? You know, you get that jet lag with your body, you can't help it all of a sudden be going, you know what? And that, you know, that's the difficult part. So it helped to be pretty much acclimatized and have a day in Turkey and then did a show at Insulek in a base where, you know, lightning was going off in the background, but for about a couple of thousand people there. And it was wild. And then from there we went to K2, another base. I think we're allowed to say K2.
Yeah.
Yeah, the mountain. We were on Everest.
How many people are on oxygen for the first time?
But it was nice because I was acclimatized, ready, and you know. And then we do these things where you just go from unit to unit to unit to unit to unit, and you'd go out and you know all of a sudden you'd be you know Marines one moment, Air Force the next, and then Army, everybody, you know, a lot of airborne, a lot of those. And sorry, I didn't mean to. Got to get it up.
That's all right.
And they have to pull your hair way back. And that was the best part. That for me, when you go up and see people, you know, and specifically units like flight line units, and every once in a while there'd be a demonstration of something, which is, you know, for me interesting because I'm fascinated by that stuff, showing off some of the toys. Mm. But that was, you know, secondary. The main thing was getting around and seeing as many people as possible in the time.
The coolest thing you saw, did they take you out on some live fire exercises or at least show you how they do some of the job out there?
Well, we're going to see that hill, Mr. Williams. Bye. It's just a hoot. He's an unexploded ordnance, sir. And if you just turn away, yeah, we're just getting rid of some. Well, I don't know if it's toxic. Bobby, is it?
It's not bad.
But, you know,
you find a lot of people wondering, me and a lot of people work in a chemical warfare unit have come here and we're bearing a dime and we're prepared to go in and do the complete search of Saddam's palace.
The coolest thing I saw, if we're allowed to talk about it, probably not because it'll be, was this thing called the Predator. I mean, it's not a known, it's on the news every night. It's basically, they call it the nickname, the flying dildo. I nicknamed it the little. But you spell it German, F-O-K-K-E-R, the little fucker, sponsored by Viagra, flies hard, flies long. And it's basically an unmanned thing, which is not very popular with Air Force officers going around, damn thing can just go off on its own and do all the work of. You need a man to determine it. And it basically, I always had a vision that there'd be one Pakistani with it, like Tyco remote control going, I can mess with you. Turn the thing, but the thing goes so high. And it was a fascinating thing to see this next step, you know, the remote controlled on, you know, this, and then they take you and say, would you like to take control? No, thank you, please. I don't want to be responsible if that thing goes, yep. Mr. Williams, I'm here from the Air Force to confiscate your house, your children.
They you send you a bill.
Yeah, here's the bill. $500 million. See that, or just gonna, you have to pour them for the rest of your life. It's going to be the drill. But that was fascinating to me.
What is the biggest reward for you? What when you go back to the States and you're hanging out with friends or you're talking with your family, what will you tell them?
The biggest reward is seeing people just happy to seeing the basic human response, as it always is, of seeing people, number one, laughing, having a great time, and said, I haven't had a laugh like that. As a comic, it's the greatest reward. It's almost like sex, except without the shower. And but you get the whole thing, and that's before. Just amazing. But it's that thing of that, you see people go, and really these hardcore guys, you go around and even while signing pictures, I do that kind of little sets, playing around with different people. There are a lot of big men in the service. One guy said, give me a kiss. I said, you have been here too long. If you're hitting on a monkey boy, you're here too long. Come here, little furry boy. Give me some sugar. Master Sergeant Gunny, put him down. Come on now, squeal like a saw. But it's just. It was always that thing of you just seeing people laughing like you're laughing, and laughing in a big way. One time we walked, and I walked into a tent. It was after everything was all over, and these guys were just watching this. And they were watching the Simpsons. No, they were watching South Park. And I walked in, and they were like, "Dude, fuck!" And in a lot of these places, they can't have beer, so they have O'Doul's, which is like a Nerf vibrator. It doesn't really do it. You can't really have much fun with it, but you kind of pretend. You see guys pretending they're loaded, like. It's an O'Doul's. Oh yeah, I know. But it was just nice, and I had with me a few kind of, you know, some CDs, strange CDs, and I said, here, this is Radiohead, enjoy. And it was like, that for me was the most fun. You just meet people. It's a one-on-one. That's the best part. And the shows. You know, in some places you can't get a couple hundred people together for security reasons. You know, you want to. But most of the time it's just people have laughing, having a good time, and going around meeting people, and it's a one-on-one. And what I pick up, they're amazing people. Like I said, men, women, all ages, all nationalities, doing extraordinary things, and they deserve it. They deserve to have someone come over and say, you rock, you're the best. And that's what I did. I want to be there, come out and not do your normal show. Dong, gosh, ain't. I couldn't do that. I would get off the plane and say, hey, it's a little cold here. My nipples are hard. Nice to see you. And that was the best part, was seeing people just kind of knowing that it was something a little different. And that, and they would laugh and have a great time and then go to the next place. Because, you know, they're there, and unless things drastically change, we're going to be there for a while. So it's good that, you know, maybe other people are trying. I'll put the word out, get out there and say, yeah, it's an interesting flight in when you spiral in, but, you know, you're basically really safe, I would say. I mean, I'm not going to go 100% and say, oh, it's totally at ease. Taliban mosquito. But, you know, you have that thing that it was worth it for me. It was great. I'm exhausted. I'm a crispy critter. Thank you for the German coffee. Are we on Germany now?
And the words you'll edit out, and obviously we've run out of funding. But that's good. Thanks to that. And
I want to say, first of all, as coming Thanksgiving season, happy Thanksgiving, and also happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, all of the holidays. And you know what it is. Very, very much the best to all you guys and girls. All of a sudden, all my cats and kittens, keep your mittens. And the folks in Bagram, the dust is blowing, but you're the best thing that's going. Kandahar, K2, Instant Lick, everybody there, and my folks in J-Bad. Whew, it was so hot, my men were lactating.